The afternoon is Dr. Arvin Weissman in Stanford University. Although he doesn't give us any abstract, we don't need it. His talk should be something related to his old and current work on hematopoietic stem cell story and early hematolymphoid development. Is it okay?
It's okay.
You have 40 minutes.
40?
Including everything. Okay.
Let me get my slides out.
Okay.
I'll probably just take 30. If Len and Lee were in the room, hey, Len, plug in your hearing aid. I would tell you that some joke about Len. He's standing out there. Dr. Herzenberg. Somebody shouted him. Anyway. When I went to Stanford Medical School, beginning in 1960, sharing a cadaver with these two people, Harvey Oser and Bob Erickson, the very first person I met at Stanford was not Len Herzenberg. It was a guy who told me I should work with Len Herzenberg. It was Av Mitchison. Yes, I wonder what that means.
Where were you
at 2 o'clock in the morning, Len? Right. So anyway, and I actually worked in Len's lab, I think from January through June of 1961. But Len was then working on histocompatibility and the nature of H2 and obviously soon HLA antigens. Just to let you know the setting and the time. At that time, the leading other group that was isolating the biochemical entity of H2 antigen was Medawar, who thought it was, for some reason, nucleoprotein. Remember that, Len? So, yes. And I came actually having worked in Ernst Eichwald's lab on HY. In fact, I got my beginning in HY, and that's why I'll be so interested to hear Liz, if she makes it in the room, about that particular subject. Obviously, whether you work in Len's lab, or Len and Lee's lab, to be honest, a short time or a long time, you're inalterably affected by the way they do science. And I, too, have been so affected. Now, over the years, Len and Lee and I have had many arguments and differences and collaborations, but I think it's very clear from the science and the training that went on, that's obvious in this room, that it's a spectacular laboratory to do science and a spectacular laboratory to be trained in science. So congratulations to you, Len. I think it's really to Len and Lee. I know Lee is being left out a fair amount, but I'm sure most of us understand it's Len and Lee. One of the areas of my, by the way, I left Len's lab, but I hope it wasn't because he kicked me out, but I was too headstrong. I wanted to continue to work on HY and the role of the thymus in... Would you control him, please?
It worked out well.
All right. It worked out well for everybody concerned. I should say that Dr. Yodori, who is chairing this session, who is a most powerful chairman, also is the nephew of a very famous sculptor in Japan, and you can go see his sculptures in the Hakone Sculpture Garden. It also says Yadoi. So, one of the first post-Len Lab collaborations I had with Len was in the late 60s during the development of the cell sorter. At that time, I was interested in the thymus and the cells that went from bone marrow to the thymus, as will be evidenced by today's talk. And I think we were one of the first ones to run live cells through the prototype sorter. And the first question we asked is, could we run bone marrow cells through the sorter and have something come out of the other side that was alive and could form late spleen colonies in lethally irradiated animals? Now, that was the assay that Till and McCulloch used to change experimental hematology from an art into a science. The first quantitative measurement of precursor cells in the hematopoietic and lymphoid system. And in fact, they thought they were working with stem cells. I think they were working with stem cells, although not all the cells they worked with were believed to be stem cells. But most of the people in the world, if you read the popular literature, that is Nature, the uncritical popular literature, think that something else is going on. If I could have the first slide. So this is a view of the system that I'm studying. And now, as I go through this system and go over the questions we're asking, at least in the context of this particular talk, it will sound very much like Mark Noble's talk. Because we're talking about stem cells, we're talking about self-renewal, the commitment to differentiation, how irreversible it is, how few cells can be multipotent, how you define what a stem cell is. So all of these cells, as you know, if you could keep the focus good, I'll keep the light on the slides. Focus. Focus on that one. The other way. Stop.
Good.
Okay. So anyway, as you'll notice in this diagram, the definition of the cell or the population of cells that we're dealing with is that these are the cells which can give rise to all lineages of blood cells. You'll notice in this diagram I have some solid lines, and that's where we feel fairly confident that the developmental lineages are known, at least roughly. You'll notice that there is no pro-lymphocyte progenitor. And that's because it's not proven by my view of the literature. There are some clinical cases that make you think there might be such a cell, but I know of no direct experiment that says there is a lymphocyte progenitor that can give rise to T and B cells, but not to myeloerythroid cells. So that's just a beginning. Now, in order to study lineages, I've always felt that you want to isolate cells at a particular stage in as pure a form as you can, and then ask when you put them back into the right microenvironment, usually an in vivo microenvironment, what its developmental potential is, first in terms of the next lineage, the next cell in the lineage, and also, now go back again.
Go back again to the
back
first slide.
Two slides.
To the first slide.
Thank you. Right. So one also needs assays for clonogenic cells. And the assay that I did in collaboration with Len and that Till and McCulloch invented was an assay that read to all of these cells out in a single colony. And the progenitor could have been this cell or this cell or this cell, or in fact even this cell if you want only myeloid colonies. So the definition that we eventually came to for stem cells was an operational definition. So for stem cells in the hematolymphoid system, the population that one finds should give rise to multiple lineages, including lymphoid lineages, as well as myeloerythroid. The degree to which the population you look at is represented in bone marrow is the degree to which it should be enriched for clonogenic cells. So if 1% of the cells has a certain marker, you should have a 100-fold enrichment in an assay for that clonogenic cell, or you're not really dealing with an enriched population that's the cell you want. The second part, which is out of practice, and really follows the horrible effects of radiation given whole body to humans or mice, is that for the dose range of a radiation that leads to death by failed hematopoiesis, bleeding due to loss of platelets, infection due to loss of granulocytes, anemia due to loss of red cells, the cell population you have should be able to replace that and thereby radioprotect the host. So radioprotection is in the assay. And the third, and maybe the most important, is that you ought to be able to assay at a later time point and show that you have renewed more stem cells. Next slide, please. Now, I believe absolutely that you have to have marker systems to tell donor from host cells. Probably the very first and best marker system, Spedding Micklem was in on its development, and Spedding, in fact, did most of the experiments that I rediscover after I've published papers and haven't cited him. But anyway, Jerry Spangrut and Shelley Heimfeld in my laboratory, using clonogenic assays for T cells, B cells, and myeloerythroid cells, isolated a population of cells representing 1 in 2,000 mouse bone marrow cells, which had this phenotype. Could you focus on that part? Which contains cells, as I will show you, that have all of the properties: multi-lineage reconstitution, radioprotection, and self-renewal of stem cells. Now, these cells were found to lack markers, which we just call lineage markers. That is, markers that are found on T cells, B cells, myelomonocytic cells, red cells. You can make a cocktail of antibodies, label them with a single fluorochrome, and you look for the lineage minus, not the lineage plus subset. The cells also had low levels of the marker Thy1 on their surface. And low means it's about 1/20th to 1/50th that you find on mature T cells, or probably on neurons if you could isolate them at the time when they're Thy1 high. But it's different from background. The other marker which we had was an antibody we obtained from Jan Klein and Yuko Aihara, which they thought was a pre-T cell antibody. It was one of 40 that they sent us. It's called SCA1. It detects a determinant on the LY6A molecule. And this combination of markers, Thy1 low, lineage minus, SCA1 plus, allowed us to isolate a population of cells which we think are stem cells. Now, it's also fairly obvious that there are very few places on Earth that this could have been done, except with the help of Dave Parks and Len and the group, the Cell Sorter Group. This is the kind of experiment that's commonplace at Stanford. It's becoming commonplace elsewhere. But the ability to do multiple color analysis, and then by reanalysis to show that you have populations that are this pure. This particular reanalysis was done by Nobuko Uchida, who is a graduate student in my lab from Japan. She thinks she's going to get out of my lab someday to come back to Japan. Maybe, maybe not. Could I have the next slide? Now, I'm not going to show you several of the assays. I'm just going to cut to the assay that I think is most important. This is the radioprotection. And in this case, we used mice that were genetically LY5.2 as donors, and we injected the cells into irradiated mice that were genetically LY5.1. LY5 is an antigenic determinant on what's called the leukocyte common antigen. And it has determinants that are on all bone marrow and blood cells except red blood cells and nucleated red cells. And it has other determinants that are cell type specific. We're looking at determinants that are on all nucleated blood cells. There are, of course, congenic strains that are genetically identical except for the LY5 markers created by Ted Boyce and colleagues. And there are monoclonal antibodies to donor and host. So this provides a quantitative marker system which you can read out not by chromosome squashes to look at the dividing subset of cells that have a chromosome marker, but every cell. And using the cell sorter, it's quantitative. So now we transplanted cells into lethally irradiated mice, and we found with whole bone marrow, the reason this doesn't have dots on it is that it's a combination of experiments from my lab and published by others. It's fairly common, this curve. It takes about 200,000 bone marrow cells to save 95 to 100% of the animals. It takes 40,000 bone marrow cells to save half of the animals. It's very reproducible, and it could be used as a quantitative assay for this radioprotective population. I should say that the animals that were saved in this experiment, whether they got whole bone marrow, our thylolin minus SCA1 plus cells, were reconstituted for at least 6 months in the TB and myelomonocytic lineages using two color staining LY5 of the donor type and then markers of T cells or B cells or monocytes or granulocytes. With thylolin minus SCA1 plus cells, it took between 85 and 100 cells to save 95 to 100% of the animals. It took between 20 and 30 cells to save half the animals. I said there was 1 in 2,000 cells that had this marker phenotype. 200,000 cells saves 95% of the animals. 200,000 divided by 2,000 is 100. So we're fairly close to the expected number. That would lead one to propose, as we argued in our first paper, that not only were these hematopoietic stem cells, but they were likely to be the only hematopoietic stem cells in the bone marrow. Next slide, please. So Nobuko Uchida decided to re-examine this issue much more critically. And she took each of the characteristic markers, Thy1 or the lineage or the SCA, and just divided the bone marrow into two populations without throwing any cells away. And now asked, what's the radioprotective and long-term reconstitutive activity of each of these two populations? So if we had missed something, we would find it this way. And we looked at the protective dose that would save 95% or 50% of the animals with each of the populations. So in this example, if 5% of the bone marrow cells were, for example, Thy1 positive, then we would transplant into animals for the 50% dose 4 times 10 to the 4th of Thy1 minus, or 2,000 of Thy1 plus cells. And that's the comparison, the amount that was contained within the 50% or the 95% protective dose of bone marrow. Next slide, please. Here's just a whole bunch of data points. The experiments were done 3 times with at least 10 animals and sometimes 20 animals per group. They were looked over very long periods of time. This is the PD50. It's the whole bone marrow. It's pretty close to 50%, pretty close to 100%, no cells. Most but not all of the animals die. Once in a while, an animal survives. The Thy1 plus but not the Thy1 minus, the SCA1 plus but not the SCA1 minus, the lineage minus but not the lineage plus gave you the expected 50% rate of protection. The reason there's a star there is that that's if we exclude one cage of animals that died of Pseudomonas infection. So you can have both of those if you like. And it was close to that for the 100% PD95, except you'll notice there are a couple of animals in these two groups that survived. In these animals, actually, we tested each of the animals, and they had a recovery of host hematopoietic cells and survived without donor contribution to TB or myeloid by 6 months. And you notice there's a little bit increased survival time of these animals. That was presumptively due to other progenitors contained in the 200,000 bone marrow cells that these animals received, from which was removed only cells that had stem cell markers. Next slide. We had reported in our first paper that when we isolated Thy1 lolin minus SCA1 plus cells, that if you stain them with propidium iodide, that on the order of 2 to 3% of the cells had S plus G2 plus M amount of DNA. We were wrong. The person who told us we were wrong was Tim Knack, whose picture you saw in Dave Park's showing of who really operates the cell sorter. Because when we were re-looking at that issue of the percentage of cells that were dividing, we looked at this. This is Thy1 lolin minus SCA1 plus, and it looked like there was a lot more there. But the first time we read the computer gatings, that said about 5 to 8%. And I knew, we knew, that something was wrong, but we didn't know what was wrong. Well, Tim just noticed that there was a great big signal here. And that signal is due to little tiny magnetic beads that we use for a positive selection step when you're doing cell sorting. So it helps to be smart, but it also helps to have Tim Knack at the cell sorter. So the smart guys in my lab were wrong. And Tim Kanak was right. And the fact is that of the total population of thylolin minus SCA1 plus cells, fully 21 to 22% have S plus G2 plus M amount of DNA. So that means that more of them probably are in cycle. And that helps explain a problem about retrovirus insertion of genes into normal stem cells that can occur at some frequency and that we thought couldn't occur in a non-dividing population. However, when you sub-fractionate this population into cells that do not stain brightly with a rhodamine, with a mitochondrial dye called rhodamine 1,2,3, that the rhodamine low cells really are virtually resting cells, and the rhodamine high cells are correspondingly enriched for cells that are dividing. Jerry Spangrud showed first, and we've repeated, that this population of cells, rhodamine high, is multipotent, gives rise to all cell lineages, but is very poor at self-renewal. So that if you look 2, 4, 6 months down the line, you cannot find more stem cells. I think that's interesting because it's the population in cycle, and it could be like O2A going to an oligo versus a type 2 astrocyte that it has a certain number of cell divisions it's going to go through. That's one hypothesis and will be interesting to test. This population is incredible. It has very high burst size, and it is long. It has the best self-renewing potential of any population of cells. The other point is that if you elutriate cells and you want to get large versus medium versus small cells, all of the rhodamine high cells and the dividing cells are in the blast cell population, which is called by Jones and Sharkus Rotoroff. And this is the population that, in fact, is in the smaller cell size, which is sedimenting at 25, 29 milliliters per minute. For those who are curious about the Jones-Sharkus paper and the ISCOV response to it, I'll just have to, at the end, hopefully get back to it if I don't use up all my time. But it's a counting error they made. I'll just leave it at that. Next slide. Okay, so now, one of the important definitions of stem cells is not only at the population level need they be multipotent, but every single cell should be multipotent. And if you have an O2A cell sitting in a dish and you're just watching it, you can watch what it becomes. But if you have stem cells that require microenvironments that are only in the body to mature to T or B or myeloid erythroid, it's tougher. So we decided we needed to have an experiment where we could record the results from a single cell injected into a mouse. This is an experiment that Laurie Smith and Nobuko Uchida did, and has been repeated many times by Nobuko. I'll just show you one example of it. We took one cell of the stem cell phenotype, thylolin minus SCA plus from the LY5.2 donor. We mixed it with 100 cells from the LY5.1 donor, the same phenotype. I told you 100 cells would save all the animals, and it does reproducibly. So now you have 101 cells you inject into an irradiated LY5.1 host, and we're going to look for those animals that have a single cell. We've done the experiment two ways. We used the cloning device to do single cells, and we also did limit dilution experiments where we know between 15 and 20 cells is the Poisson single hit. We've done them both ways. I'm going to show you an animal that came from a cell sorter cloning. Next slide. So we now look in the bloodstream of these animals, and we use the LY5.2 marker above the line staining, and then each of the lineage markers to the right. And you can see in this animal, not a representative animal, it's the best animal we ever had. There were B cells, non-B cells, T cells, non-T cells, myelomonocytic and non-myelomonocytic cells. This animal was sacrificed for this experiment at 8 months after a single cell was injected. About half of the cells in each of the classes came from that donor single cell. Half apparently came from the other 100 cells we injected. So it's clear that it's multipotent. Every animal that showed a donor population gave you T, B, and myeloid. Every animal. So every one of these cells is multipotent. In one-third of the cases, we got long-term self-renewal, and I'll show you how we assayed it in a minute. In two-thirds to three-quarters of the cases, the multilineage output was followed by a drop first in myelomonocytic cells, persistence of T and B cells, I think relating to their lifespan, and then loss of stem cells from the bone marrow. So how do you measure stem cells in the bone marrow? You sacrifice the animal. You re-isolate populations of cells. Next slide. In this one, we used just the LY5.2 marker only to get out LY5.2 cells. That's what Laurie Smith did. Nabucco has repeated this by getting out thylolin minus SCA1 plus cells of the donor phenotype from animals that were single cell reconstituted 8 months to a year and a half after reconstitution and retransfer it to a second lethally irradiated animal. And you get myelomonocytic, non-myelomonocytic, T, non-T, B, non-B, again, for up to a year after that. So a single cell could give rise to billions of blood cells and self-renew in this animal on the order of 5 to 8,000 cells that could give day 12 spleen colonies and about 500 cells minimum estimate for the long-term reconstitution potential. And that we've done many, many times. So I think we've fulfilled all the definitions of a stem cell. They radioprotect to the percentage that they are represented in the population. They are multilineage. There are no other cells that have this property. And they self-renew many, many stem cells in the microenvironment of the animal. Next slide, please. This is what the cells look like. This is from one of the reanalysis. They're ordinary-looking cells. If you were a morphologist, you'd say they were lymphocytes. I would have said they're lymphocytes, but they're not lymphocytes. They're obviously stem cells. Next slide. If Herb Kaiser had been here, the other person who was on the anatomy team with Harvey and Bob and I would have really gone into this part because Herb Kaiser told me when I was telling him we were isolating stem cells, he said, yeah, that's okay, but you'll never use it for bone marrow transplants because stem cells will not be able to give rise to granulocytes, platelets, or red blood cells in a sufficient amount of time. And I bet him. So I asked him how long it would take, and he thought it would take. Stem cells might catch up to the rest of the progenitors, the clonogenic progenitors, for each of the lineages in about 2 weeks. So now, in this experiment, Nabucco Uchida did this, not in response to her, because we were already doing it. We took 500 thylolin minus SCA1 plus cells, and we compared them to 10 to the 6 bone marrow, which contain 500 thylolin minus SCA plus cells, and looked at their ability to give rise to donor-derived blood cells. We didn't have a mark for platelets or hematocrit, so we just counted them. And what's clear is that there may be a small difference in time, and there may be some differences in the amount you get, but stem cells can restore the hematopoietic system with roughly the same efficiency as the whole bone marrow that contains that amount of stem cells. So that means in the setting of a bone marrow transplant, the other progenitors don't contribute very much. We can isolate lineage-committed progenitors to myelomonocytic cells and to B cells to show that such cells exist and they have a decent burst size, but they're nothing compared to stem cells. Next slide, please. Okay, now I'm going to do I'm going to go over a series of experiments carried out by Koichi Ikuta. You can say it the right way for me, who is now at the University of Tokyo and spent several years in my lab. Koichi was interested in the same developmental questions that interest Mark Noble and Lee and Len Herzenberg, and that was the question of, during ontogeny, do stem cells change their ability to be determined to have a certain outcome, fetal versus adult outcome? Now, as Mark said, the globin switch is a perfectly good system in man in which you could ask for embryonic or fetal or adult outcomes. In the mouse, it's not quite so clear that you can use three different systems. You might have a fetal and adult globin, but it's not very clean. But what was very clean coming from the work of Wendy Havren and Jim Allison, following up on work by Tonegawa and Rollet and others on the gamma delta T cell system, is that there are waves of cells developing in the mouse thymus that have particular T cell receptors. And I should say, Nicole Durand's studies on chick quail embryos really presage all of these studies in terms of understanding that there are waves of T cell development in the thymus. Now, this particular set of waves are defined by monoclonal antibodies to the variable region of the T cell receptor V gamma subsets. And the first wave is V gamma 3, second V gamma 4, V gamma 2 and V gamma 5 we didn't put in, and then the alpha beta T cell receptors come up. So they each have a peak time in the gestation of the animal when they're reached. This is a relative number of cells. It's a fraction of the CD3 positive or T cell receptor positive subset of cells in the thymus. Now what's interesting about this is not only that you have waves of development, and you can ask, do you get this with fetal or adult stem cells, or this with adult or fetal stem cells? But you can also have a look at the gene order in the next slide. And on the gamma chromosome, the order of their appearance in ontogeny is collinear with their physical order on the chromosome. So the one that comes up first is the one that's closest to the J to which it must rearrange to be expressed, and second and third and fourth. And of course, the work of Haver and Allison and the others showed that the V gamma 3 cells will go to the skin, the V gamma 4 to the female reproductive epithelium, and both male and female tongue epithelium. And I wouldn't touch that any further. These go to the spleen, and the V gamma 5 go to the intestine. So now we had markers, we had developmental sequence, and the question is, can adult and fetal stem cells go through both of these ordered stages of development? So Koichi took the model of fetal thymic organ cultures set up initially, I believe, by Jenkinson and Owen, cleared them of most cells, just like irradiation, but with deoxyguanosine, and seeded cells, stem cells, into these same fetal thymic organ cultures using donors of different ages. Next slide. When he did so, here's whole fetal liver or whole adult bone marrow or the stem cell subset of these cells. And what's important is that you get with fetal liver or stem cells from it the percentage of cells that you expect to be of the total population expressing V gamma 3. So fetal cells in this system do what they should. They give rise to V gamma 3. But adult bone marrow or adult stem cells give rise to no detectable numbers of V gamma 3 T cells. Now, I'm not going to show you the data, but these two populations, when put into the adult mouse thymus, only give the adult outcome. So development is occurring both inherent in the stem cell population and in the microenvironment that somehow allows the stem cells to read out. Next slide. To do this experiment appropriately, you should do it at limit dilution to look at what a single cell can do. And we did that with whole populations and with the with whole populations and with stem cell subsets of whole populations. And, I mean, it's obvious that you could have had waves of V gamma 3 cells derived from a stem cell that could only give rise to V gamma 3, and then the V gamma 4 from another stem cell that could only give rise to V gamma 4. Or a single cell could give rise to all the waves, and what happens during development is you restrict the possibilities. It's the latter that occurs. At the single cell level, this is just one of many examples, you get V gamma 3 positive cells and other CD3 positive cells. When you stain with the general gamma delta stain, there are gamma delta cells and alpha beta cells all within the same clone, and this is a repeatable phenomenon. So that it looks like at the level of the stem cell, there is a determination of outcome. But the determination doesn't say you're restricted to one outcome, it's whether you can read the whole set of gamma, delta, and alpha, beta possibilities. Next slide, please. Okay, now, it's been known for years that when immunoglobulin and T cell receptor genes come together, particular chromosomes have N nucleotides put in the middle, at the junction. The gamma chromosome can happen. As Havern and Allison showed, or Allison anyway in his group showed, for the skin V gamma 3 cells, there are no N nucleotides at the junctions. Even though they're independently arising skin clones, there's no N nucleotides put in. In V gamma 4 cells that you find in the reproductive epithelium or when they're present in the thymus, there are N nucleotides put in. And what's interesting is that that too is developmentally regulated. Because stem cells that come from embryonic 14-day fetal liver, this reads 19 out of 21 cases, there were no N nucleotides put in. And here's the other two cases that were in frame. From adult bone marrow, bone marrow or stem cells, 3 out of 17 had no N nucleotides, and the other 14 out of 17 had N nucleotides put in. So that means, at least at the level of gamma delta, V gamma 4 T cells, that during the maturation, you have added the capacity to put N nucleotides in. So the enzymatic machinery, which almost certainly by Alton Baltimore's studies, includes the enzyme TDT. Next slide. So to summarize this part, at the level of the stem cell, it looks like, with time, first, that you can read out the whole repertoire from a single cell. As time goes on, you drop out the capacity to read out particular fates quantitatively. It's a quantitative phenomenon. You can still find some adult stem cells that'll give rise to V gamma 4. That's why we could analyze it. Also, as time goes on, we presume, although we don't know for sure, you go from off to on for TDT activity. Koichi is now examining the alpha-beta T-cell receptor, the beta sequences from these clones, and early analysis seems to say that TDT is working when you go from the gamma-delta to the alpha-beta switch, because there are N nucleotides in the clones of at least some of the V-beta cells, although that's early days, and you can ask Koichi to give you a talk, and he'll tell you the full story. What I find that's fascinating about this is another kind of a developmental clock. This is a developmental clock that's reading down a chromosome. Now, it would be fascinating if the clock was on the chromosome itself, that you opened up chromatin and then closed down chromatin and transcriptional factors could act on it. And that's a very exciting possibility. Certainly, at the level of the stem cell, there is a determination of whether or not you can read these out. But I should tell you, there are lots of other possibilities for it. One that is intriguing, and certainly it's consistent with the B cell story of the isotype switch, for those who are aficionados, where known growth factors like IL-4 or IL-5 or gamma interferon or TGF-beta can cause first sterile transcription of particular downstream constant regions, and then rearrangements to those places where sterile transcripts had occurred. So this clock, which is so fascinating to us, could be a clock of receptors for yet unknown growth factors that are present in the thymus and to which stem cells can respond. And there are other possibilities, but those are two of the intriguing possibilities. Next slide, please. Now, there is a genetics to hematopoiesis, and you all know about it from probably at least from Shin Nishikawa's beautiful work, that there are two developmental defects that were believed to be relating to hematopoietic stem cells in mice. And these are the WW anemias and Steele anemias. It turns out that the gene that encodes the W locus has been cloned. It is a tyrosine kinase homodimeric receptor, the product of the c-KIT gene. Several people, Besmer and others, have cloned this. And its ligand is the product of the Steele gene locus. And Steele can be made as a membrane-bound most effective factor or a soluble less effective factor. And the belief was that this was acting not just on hematopoietic cells, but on stem cells. So it was worth looking at that question and looking at it genetically. So we chose two things. First, we wanted to know, was c-KIT present on stem cells? And second, did you have to have c-KIT or Steele factor to make stem cells? Next slide. Now, this is one of many experiments that Koichi did. Koichi made monoclonal antibodies against the ectodomain of mouse c-KIT. And he did it using Nishikawa's method. And that tells you something right away. That is, they can isolate from WW mice. He did actually WW, the deletion of the W locus. Obtained mast cells from those embryos. Mast cells come from stem cells. So already there's something wrong. Added IL-3 to it, grew up those cells. Added IL-3 to normal littermate mast cells, immunized with the normal littermate mast cells, selected for an antibody that would not see WW, but would see the normal. I'm going as fast as I can, Junji. And so using that those antibodies, he could isolate. And the most important thing is that in the thylo Lin minus SCA1 plus, c-kit plus subset, at limiting numbers of cells, those cells give rise to multilineage myelomonocytic B and T cell repopulation. But the c-kit minus subset of these cells, which represents maybe 20% of the cells, there was no multilineage reconstitution in large numbers of animals. So the first point is, c-kit is indeed on stem cells in fetal life and adult life. So what happens if you have a steal-steal mutation, where there is no steal gene possible? Next slide. Koichi looked at these animals, and this is instructive, first because it's a hard experiment, and second because it tells us something about the dynamics of stem cell number increase. This is just the number of cells phenotypically, the thylo-Lin minus SCA plus. This is mirrored by reconstitution experiments and in vitro experiments. I'm just going to show you some of the cell numbers. I don't want you to look at all this stuff, even though it's interesting. In the littermates that are plus, either plus plus or plus steel, at day 13, 14, and 15 gestation, you can see a significant number, 1,000 to 2,000 of these stem cells, and they're doubling about every day. In the mice that lack steel factor completely, you also see a number of these cells, roughly 40% of that level, and they're doubling every day, and this is in a large number of animals now. So in a steal-steal mice that doesn't have an endogenous capacity to make the steal factor, you're still developing stem cells. I should say that we don't have an antibody that is neutralizing steal factor, so we cannot rule out that some steal factor from the maternal circulation caused the development of those cells. But I can tell you that Ann Tsukamoto, in an entirely independent and parallel set of experiments, has shown that the WW deletion mice had the same number of developing stem cells. And in both the steal-steal and the WW mouse, they have perfectly normal thymic lymphocyte development. So I would say what's clear, unless there's some real artifact in here, is that steal factor and c-kit are involved in hematopoiesis at an early stage, but not at the generation of stem cells, and not necessarily in their cell division. The second thing I'd point out, mainly to Mark, is that it's likely their doubling time is about every day. And as I showed you, the determination differences, every day you change a V-gamma-3 possibility, is extremely interesting. As if at every cell division, developmental choices are changing. That's as if. It's also obvious that Lennon Lee and I have to finish the experiment of asking at the single cell level whether a single cell changes the frequency of its choices to become B1, B2, B1 versus B2 cells, B cells. And if we had the right markers for hemoglobin, we would like to run that story by also, to look at a set of traits that may be inherent in stem cells. And most importantly, we need to know if the stem cells on day 14 and day 15 are really derived from the ones that were there day 12 and 13. Next slide. I'll move a little faster. When you treat a whole animal with steel factor, this is Harv Fleming's experiment, this just is correlative. What happens to the animal after a week-long treatment that gives you massive changes in the blood cell picture? The number of stem cells in the bone marrow actually goes down over that week. And there is a great increase in the number of stem cells in the spleen. This is a phenotypic marker. We did CFUS and long-term reconstitution. It fits with this perfectly well. So that the total number of stem cells in the animal is constant. Now, we did a fair number of time points, 4, 7, 10. And we have no change yet in the stem cell number. We have a change in the distribution of stem cells. And I think that one of the effects of this could be that cells that were stem cells in the bone marrow are leaving the bone marrow and going to the spleen. This is just the four long bones. That's all the bones together. But it will take us reproducing Spedding-Micklem's classic 1964 experiment, was it Spedding? By irradiating the long bones. Was it about then? Yeah. Spedding did the experiment that you can irradiate the long bones of the animal, inject bone marrow IV, and it will populate the long bones and hardly populate the other bone marrow. So now you have an animal, say, at 4 weeks' time point, where all of the stem cells here, and therefore 15% of the stem cells in the body are in the long bones, and the spleen has maybe 1% or less. So we will do that experiment. Okay, I will take 3 minutes.
Zero.
0 minutes.
Just 1 minute or 2 minutes.
The next slide. I would have told you about the identity of the human hematopoietic stem cell, but I think...
Dr. Tokuhisa was very...
That's why I put these slides last. Okay, I'll just take a couple minutes. Okay, sorry. So, it's obvious that if you have quantitative assays for clonogenic precursors and in vivo reconstitution as a possibility, you could study stem cells in any species. The species of choice here is man for obvious reasons. So at Systemics, a company I helped co-found, not in my laboratory, I want to make that clear, it's separate, a group headed by Chuck Baum, Bruno Peyot, and others, including Seishi Kiyoizumi, who is here somewhere, there he is back in the corner, began working on human hematopoiesis. And began from the point of a famous Becton-Dickinson antibody, the antibody to CD34, where Kurt Siven had showed previously that in some progenitor assays, CD34 marked a population of progenitors and was largely absent of mature cells. And we found when we went back that there are cells with mature markers in the CD34 subset, and so we wanted to go much further than CD34. So we're looking at fetal human bone marrow, and these are the lineage markers we use to get rid of the lineage positive cells. We found that human Thy1 is expressed on about 5% of the CD34 plus subset, and in our hands, 2 to 8% of the CD34 positive cells of the bone marrow are CD34 positive. Next slide, I'll do this quick. We set up a co-culture assay. We found that there was one particular mouse stromal cell line which could support human hematopoiesis and would give rise to both myeloid and B lymphoid cells. Next slide. If you look at whole bone marrow in a quantitative assay in the ability to initiate these long-term cultures that are both B and myeloid, CD34 plus but not 34 minus compared to whole bone marrow, had the activity. Lineage minus was much better than lineage plus. CD34 plus thigh plus was much better than CD34 plus thigh minus by orders of magnitude. And the orders of magnitude are consistent with the percentage of cells in each of those categories. Next slide. Then you can subset the cells even more, and now we did, all of the experiments below the line were done with FACS-sorted single cells put into this mouse stromal co-culture. And what you read out here is the frequency of cultures that are positive and whether they're both lymphoid and myeloid or not. So it's in the thigh plus 34 plus, not thigh minus. Thigh plus lin minus, poor in thigh plus lin plus, as you can see. It's in 34 plus lin minus, better than 34 plus lin plus. Thigh plus 34 plus rhodamine low has it, but the rhodamine high subset doesn't. These were done different days. The absolute numbers vary somewhat, so that's why things look a little odd. And thigh plus lin minus 34 plus has it. Thigh minus lin minus 34 plus doesn't. Next slide. You can do lots of repetitive experiments. These are these experiments. This is the actual data that led to the thigh plus 34 plus number that we saw. 576 wells, 700, you know, lots and lots of wells were analyzed. And reproducibly, this is the fraction that are lymphoid and myeloid. The activity is in the thigh plus 34 plus, not the thigh minus 34 plus. Next slide. The next was an in vivo assay. We had a lack of medical students who wanted to be irradiated and reconstituted. So we, that is Mike McCune and I and Hideto Kanashima, Reiko Namikawa, developed the Skid Hugh mouse, into which you can implant human fetal thymus. It will grow. If you section through it, it has human thymic lymphocytes. As we reported, if there is no source of hematopoietic cells, they grow and then they stop. If you add more hematopoietic progenitors, they grow again. We injected into these, that is Bruno Pio injected into these, sorted cells, the next slide, Cells that have 5 plus, 34 plus, are much better at reconstituting over the long term than 5 plus, 34 minus. It's quantitative. It's not 100%. Part of this, well, in fact, it's been reported in JEM and in PNAS, and so you can look at the actual data itself. Next slide. Now, one of the great things that Seishi Kirizumi did was to develop a method to implant human fetal bone into SCID mice. It supports hematopoiesis of several different cell types. You could focus that a little bit. And in preliminary experiments, again using fetal bone marrow as a source, next slide, Bruno and the group injected CD34 plus thigh plus focus versus CD34 plus thigh minus. Many little bones were injected. In 2 out of 9 of the experiments we reported in, several thereafter, the 34 plus thigh plus, but not 34 plus thigh minus, could give rise to donor-derived cells with B lymphoid or myeloid markers. Now, it's important to note here that the frequency is not 100%, that we used fetal bone marrow, and that we had to cross an HLA barrier because there are no LY5 congenic humans. So all of the experiments with thymic reconstitution and bone reconstitution required crossing an HLA barrier, and I can tell you in mice, if we use stem cells to cross an H2 barrier, even 5,000 stem cells will not engraft, even in lethally irradiated mice, and that's almost certainly due to NK phenotype cells that resist irradiation and that block grafting, and with the help of Ko Okamura, who I keep following scientifically, I didn't know it, but I keep following scientifically, we will, I think, collaborate to work on whether his system of anti-LFA1, anti-ICAM antibodies will permit engraftment in mouse and then eventually in man. So next slide is the final slide. Just to say, there's much you can do with human stem cells. Some of them are obvious and some are non-obvious. They're obviously the cell type you want to put genes into for various therapies. They're obviously the cell type you want to know if they're involved in a disease like chronic myelogenous leukemia or AIDS. Do they have HIV genomes in them? The non-obvious ones, which are ones that even an experiment I did in high school with HY, is that when you do a bone marrow transplant that's successful, you can put any organ graft with the small possible exception of skin from that donor into that host. So I think human stem cells are going to be an interesting field. Thank you.
We expired all the time for him, but we need to discuss something, please.
That's a question you should ask Spedding, because he's done that experiment. I have not done that experiment. One of the markers. We use GR1 also. Oh, yeah. At 2 weeks, all you see is the myeloid. At 3 weeks, you start seeing B lymphoid. At 4 to 5 weeks, you start seeing T lymphoid. Now, we've gone through, and I didn't go through it, many different marker combinations. And we never see T and B alone, never. We see myeloid alone, which gives rise to myelomonocytic cells, granulocytes and macrophages. We see B cells alone, but we've never seen with those, any of the phenotypes we have, just T and B. No, the tissues are there ahead of time. What's really interesting, it's not my work, it's from Jim Allison, is that first wave of V gamma 3 seems to be gone by day 19 gestation, yet the skin is growing throughout life, and virtually every keratinocyte is contacted by one of these cells. So there's considerable amount of extrathymic amplification. We've only done one experiment where we ask what's the stem cells left by a retransfer. That was with GM-CSF plus, now we've done steel. And in neither of those cases do you deplete the stem cell pool. That's all I can say about it. Now, there's a problem with 5-FU treatment in that it gets rid of lots of dividing cells. And in fact, once we looked at it and increased the number of cells that were staining with propidium iodide, but we failed to do full reconstitution. Krista Muller has done it, and she says that cell per cell, the post-5-FU cells are less efficient in stem cell reconstitution activity. I haven't done that.
Suzuki, please.
After bone marrow transplants in adults, we did not see at all V-gamma 3. We saw just a tiny amount of V-gamma 4, so we couldn't see that.
B?
Yeah, I should say that Laurie Smith did look at CD5 in several of those examples. Those were 3 to 4 week donors. And in the one I showed you, there were CD5 plus and CD5 minus B cells. But that's a single anecdote. I think that Randy and Kyoko's data is better.
Just one question. Yeah. What is the definition of the aging on the stem cells?
The definition of aging? It's the age of the donor. we see no phenotypic changes by the markers we've used at any stage during the mouse development, which is encouraging.
Good. This is the last question, please. Dr. Harvey.
So the question was, when we inject the LY5 congenic, do they have independent seeding of bone marrow, spleen, and thymus? Well, we know by quantitative experiments they can seed the thymus independent of the bone marrow. They can. And the spleen colony assays, it looks like they're seeding the spleen, but we have not done a rigorous experiment to see if early progenitors that spend a short amount of time with bone marrow didn't then go to the spleen. So I can't tell you the answer.
Okay, we should move to the next. Thank you, Arvin. The next is Dr. Elizabeth Simpson. Please. I hope she may keep in time. The title is Endogenous Ligands, which select the T cell repertoire.
Is on shirts that are fastened the male way round. It's a sort of discrimination I've not come upon before. Right. My association with the Herzenberg lab, for those who are interested in the historical background, goes back to the early 70s. I was really adopted by Len and Lee because at that time I was working in John Wunderlich's lab, so I could be reasonably called the first of their grandchildren. I was spending a sabbatical at NIH with John in the period immediately after he had discovered ways of keeping T cells in vitro growing and differentiating them to make cytotoxic effector cells. And his lab was in fact the first to do this. And learning that in vitro technology and approach for investigating the functional differentiation of T cells really set the scene for my subsequent career looking at differentiated T cells specific for minor histocompatibility antigens and autoantigens. So I have to him to thank, but also him to thank for putting me in contact with the lab in Stanford. You hear a great deal these days about cloning by phone. In those days, of course, there were neither DNA clones nor T-cell clones. The only clones that existed in those days were tumor clones that were autonomous. We hadn't discovered the factors that would allow us to grow T cells in vitro at that time. Nor were, whilst the FACS sorter was in its infancy as far as being used for biological experiments at that time, the FAX machine for transmitting information simultaneously did not exist. So that meant that if you did experiments collaboratively across the 3,000 miles of the United States mainland, which is what we did during this year, you had to clone by Watts line. Because at NIH at that time, the telephone connection was such that one could make what was effectively free telephone calls all over the states. So that meant that in some intriguing experiments that were started by Mike Julius, in which he found that nylon wool separated T cells, nylon wool separated cells from human peripheral blood were enriched for T cells, and because of course of the interest of the Herzenberg lab in mouse T cells, and because they knew of my work with John Wunderlich looking at the in vitro generation of effector T cells, over the telephone we decided that it might be rather fun to see if we could enrich T cells on nylon wool and get them to make in vitro responses, which after a substantial period of time we did, because whilst human T cells are pretty tough and could withstand sitting on leukopak nylon for the hour or so necessary, the nylon wool in those days had a large number of toxins in it. And it was, I'm not quite sure what series of accidents allowed us in John's lab, I think probably some accidental washing of some nylon wool that was going on at the time that was subsequently dried out and used for separation. And lo and behold, we got functional activity. So that's the history of the Julius, Simpson, and Herzenberg paper. And it was a result of a lot of phone calls, and I think that that paper was in fact written and submitted before I made my first trip to visit the Herzenberg lab. But it's 20 years ago is actually too long to remember all of those details of those dates. But having got the T-cell responses in vitro and knowing that nylon wool was a very good way of purifying T-cells from spleen, the next step in this collaboration was to use the newly developed cell sorter, then functioning in Stanford and probably nowhere else in the world at that time, for exploring a question that Harvey Kanter and I had been interested in looking at after his sabbatical, his first postdoctoral position in the National Institute for Medical Research in London, where I had also been working prior to going to the States. And we decided to look at TT cooperation in generation of the cytotoxic T cell response. And we separated cells on the basis of the level of expression of the Phi-1 molecule. In the spleen, there are Phi-1 highs and Phi-1 intermediates. And they probably correspond to the two subpopulations, CD4 and CD8, This we didn't know, of course, at that time. Those antibodies weren't available. But we had separated on the basis of Thy1 levels and showed cooperative responses after the separated cells were then reassociated in vitro cultures. And that was a very exciting time. But I seem to remember experiments starting at 5 o'clock in the morning and going on till midnight, so they were quite tiring. Well, that's almost enough of history. But my contact with the Herzenbergs, having started in such a fruitful way and with such entertaining results and interesting interactions with other scientists and instrumentation, made quite sure that I kept contact with them over the subsequent years. And when they came to do a sabbatical in Cambridge in the mid-70s, we did some collaborative experiments in London. In fact, Len and I together made the first TT hybridomas in collaboration with Barbara Osborne and Dick Goldsby. And in fact, this meeting is the first occasion on which I've met my other collaborator in those experiments. So these meetings have a very important function. My interest in T cells and T cell recognized epitopes then moved off in rather different directions, although it has to be said that I was sufficiently entranced with the fax machine at that time that our lab was the first one to buy a BD machine, which in fact was such an early fax machine that it didn't even have fax 1 written on it. It was just fax. And we had an extremely good operator in Andrew Edwards who kept fax up and running until about 3 years ago when, following a visit to Lee and Len, who were then on sabbatical again in Paris, and I saw the machine, the FaxStar Plus, after the nylon filter had been reinserted. And it was up and running and impressed me sufficiently that we were able to replace our incredibly antique fax machine at the CRC with a FaxStar Plus within the last 2 or 3 years. So we can now do all these pretty things that other people can do. And what I'm going to talk to you about this afternoon is some work using antibodies against monoclonal antibodies against V-beta regions, which have been developed in our lab by Kyuhei Tominari, by having raised T-cell clones specific for a number of minor histocompatibility antigens and using them to immunize mice and rats, and most of the anti-V-beta reagents have in fact come from immunization of rats with these T-cell clones, and have raised a number of really very interesting anti-V-beta reagents. And being Japanese and extremely thorough, one of the things that Kyuhei Tominari did with these antibodies was extremely careful strain distribution pattern analyses of V-beta usage. And it's this that led our lab into the discovery, the co-discovery, because there were another four labs who did this simultaneously, of the mouse mammary tumor viruses as integral self genes that encoded ligands which caused V-beta selection. And I apologize, but only marginally, for the long introduction, because in some ways I think history is at least as interesting as one's yesterday's results. But if I can have the first slide, I'll take the precaution of actually mentioning my co-workers in the lab, their names and contributions, since that way I can't forget something which is so vital. I've mentioned Kyuhei's name already. He was the person who started this project by making the reagents. Sue Fairchild has worked with him on the phenotypic analysis, the fax analysis. Julian Dyson is our molecular biologist, who together with his research assistant, Andy Knight, did the chromosomal localization and some very nice in vitro translation experiments which have identified the molecular nature of this superantigen. Have the next slide, please. Right, okay. Well, rather like the immune system, I guess. It's.
You can just have this and this.
Okay. There is indeed some redundancy built into this. Okay. That was very helpful, Len. I was actually trying to work out how I was going to stop myself tripping over. Now, which of these two is better? I think I feel more comfortable with the old-fashioned sort. Okay. Now, this is some very interesting new phenotypic features arriving on this slide. Could we focus that, please? I suppose this is actually a very interesting way of doing functional development in the thymus. I mean, it's not obviously a real fax picture, but in fact it's a diagrammatic representation which allows us to follow the development of precursor thymic cells that are double negatives through into the double positive stage, during which they're developing, they're rearranging their alpha and beta chains and co-expressing them with CD3 on the cell surface, at which stage they are extremely sensitive to having their receptors cross-linked with self ligands, which leads to apoptosis. And shortly after that, or maybe almost at the same time, they are positively selected, or those that have not gone into apoptosis are positively selected into single positives on the basis of the affinity, presumably a lower level of affinity of their T-cell alpha-beta receptors for self-MHC molecules. And most of my talk is going to focus on the identity of those self-ligands co-recognized with MHC class 2 molecules that lead to apoptosis. But if there's time at the end of my talk, Irv Weissman would certainly make time. I'll tell you about some more recent experiments where positive selection, even of CD8 cells, by a self-ligand or ligands, seems also to be occurring. These are such crucial events during thymic differentiation. Negative selection to remove autoreactivity, and positive selection to give the repertoire which makes MHC-restricted responses, that clearly everything that we have known about the development of T-cell, functional T-cell responses can be accounted for by these phenomena. And I think that what the systems that I'm going to tell you about in just a moment, these mouse mammary tumor viruses, may or may not themselves be functionally important. But what they have shown us very elegantly is that negative selection does occur, and they've led on to experiments to define the conditions under which we can actually see positive selection as well. And I think that what the positive and negative selection, although one might have guessed that both occurred, these sorts of experiments provide the first experimental evidence that this is an important part of T-cell development. So they're model systems in a way. Next slide, please. Now, I'm going to present a small amount of new data on V-beta-3 deletion, and going to just quickly run over our finding of the MTB integrations which were associated with V-beta-11 deletion, and all this slide is a current list of all the identified mouse mammary tumor viruses which are integrated in the genomes of various mouse strains and which have been shown to give rise to deletions or partial deletions. But also, there are examples of positive selection events, and there are at least half a dozen examples here where we have very good evidence of particular V-betas, V-beta-6, V-beta-17, V-beta-4, V-beta-10, positive selection of these. And there is no information about these positive selections, about the ligand involved, although clearly whatever that ligand is associated with an MHC molecule. The data we have so far indicates that if there's another ligand associated with the MHC, for example, a peptide is certainly a possibility, there's no evidence with the mouse strains we've used for polymorphism. But that shouldn't discourage us for looking for such polymorphisms, since the V Beta 17A story was one that gave rise to a great deal of despair at one time. In fact, this slide is not up to date, because although the work of Marcia Blackman identified MTV3 as one of the self ligands co-recognized with the A molecule for V Beta 17A deletion, the work of other labs, including David Woodman, has shown that MTV6 and MTV9 are also responsible for V Beta 17A deletion. And if you look at the various mouse strains that are commonly used in the laboratory, all of which were shown to have the ligand that could lead to V Beta 17A deletion. So any mouse strain with an E molecule deleted V Beta 17A when they carried the V Beta 17A genomic gene. All of those mouse strains had either MTV3, MTV6, MTV8, and there aren't any common laboratory mouse strains that don't have one or other of these MTVs. So just because it's difficult to find polymorphism doesn't mean to say that you shouldn't use all the tricks in the book for using other species, for example. Spretus is one that we're currently checking on to look for these ligands, because personally I think it's quite likely that some of these unknown ligands will be turn out to be very interesting molecules that are co-expressed with MHC molecules to produce these effects. Right. Now, I've talked about the mouse mammary tumor virus integrations. Let's discuss very briefly what we know about those. Next slide, please. These MTVs are type B retroviruses. They occur in mouse. This slide is also out of date. There are now at least 45 independent integrations which have been described. Most strains have a few copies, 2 to 5, although some strains have many more, 8, 9. Spretus has got 11 integrations. There are rare mice, and the Czech mouse strain, which has been now inbred, developed at NIH, is one example of one where there aren't any MTV integrants. But that is rare. Most mouse strains have got them. And in fact, they've got them because of the random chromosomal integration of exogenous milk mammary tumor virus, which is normally passed in those strains that are carrying the milk mammary virus from the mammary gland into the sucklings when they suckle. The virus then gets carried around, probably by activating T cells because of the affinity for the different V beta chains, carried around from the gut by the lymphocytes to the mammary gland, where it gets activated during lactation. Because it's a retrovirus, it reverse transcribes itself into DNA occasionally, and very, very occasionally it does so in germ cells. And then it's inherited as a Mendelian dominant. I've mentioned the expression in mammary tissue. In lymphoid tissue, the integrated viruses are generally defective and they don't make infective virus particles. Either bits of their env, pol, or gag gene have been deleted, so there's no infection. But almost all of them have got both LTRs intact. And the next slide shows a diagram of the structure of these integrants. So the 5' prime and the 3' prime LTR, varying parts of the gag, pol, and env genes. And this mark in the LTR is to indicate that there is, in fact, an open reading frame in the LTR. And to cut a long story short, and in fact this has been published from a number of labs now, so probably well known to all of you, it's this open reading frame within the LTR which encodes the product, which is the superantigen that binds, in the first instance, to class 2 molecules in B cells, and it's the expression of that open reading frame glycoprotein which leads to the deletion of the V-beta in a V-beta-specific way. Now, in our lab, we were not the first people to describe the open reading frame protein. That this was done coincidentally in vivo by Hans-Acker Orbea in transgenic mice. and by the Marek Kapler lab using transfection. And this has been these experiments have been reproduced in several labs now. And we carried on by looking at constructs of the open reading frame, and this is work that's been done by Andy Knight and Julian Dyson, recently published in EJI, and there's also been a paper published in JEM by the Marek Kapler lab. Both have come to the same conclusion, that the open reading frame protein is an integral membrane protein of the type 2 sort. If I can have the next slide, please. That diagrammatically, this is just a brief interjection of the a southern blot of different mouse strains that's been probed with either a 5' or a 3' probe, and you can see from this the number of different integrations. These DNAs were actually cut with EcoR1, and this is just the number of bands and the size of the bands characteristic of that enzymic digestion for each of these laboratory strains. And you can see that the number of integrants varies in NOD from a couple. There's a female mouse. There's an additional band. There's an MTV integration on the Y chromosome in NOD. And the fact that it hasn't shown up in this blot means that this was a female that was done here. You can see the DBA2 has got a fair number, more, in fact, than is shown using this particular probe. But I'll come back to that point. If I can have the next slide. This is a diagrammatic representation of the results obtained from the in vitro translation experiments that I mentioned, in which this integral, the biosynthesis, have shown that the protein has got its C-terminus external, its N-terminus inside the cell. It's a glycosylated protein, glycoprotein, and its binding site, this is from work of Anne Pullen, has been shown to be on the V-beta chain at a site far distant from the binding of that the T-cell receptor to the peptide sitting in the antigen-binding groove. And this superantigen, this endogenous superantigen, which is threaded through the membrane, also binds to the beta chain, in fact, of the MHC class II molecule, and thus bridges the antigen-presenting cell, which is almost always a B cell, with the T cell receptor of the T cell, and causes the triggering event, which in the thymus leads to apoptosis, and in the periphery to the characteristic proliferative responses that are seen in the MLS different strains. This association with the endogenous superantigens is somewhat different from the association of the exogenous bacterial superantigens, which also cross-link the T-cell receptor and the class II positive cell, but they do this exterior to the cell, and there's no component that goes through the cell membrane, and not only is there no need for processing, but in fact there's no evidence that processing of this antigen, the superantigen, takes place in order to put it in this association. Have the next slide, please. Now, that's telling you the punchline before I tell you the data, but it would be a pity not to see any facts data. So people can sit back and relax a little bit. There's going to be a bit of genetics in this too, so that will be also a diversion. This is the sort of result which Kyuhei Tominari obtained when he was looking at the strain distribution pattern of the beta-11 expression in the periphery of different mouse strains. And whilst the majority of mouse strains with an E molecule, such as the H2K strains here and the H2D strains, all of them deleted their V-beta-11 cells. There was an example, the C58 strain, which, like the CBA, was H2K and also had an E molecule, but did not delete the V-beta 11 cells. And the finding of this negative strain has enabled the genetic mapping of the ligands which cause deletion. And F1 analysis shown that an F1 between C58 and the deleting strains, always deleted, an F1 between the non-deleting strain and one of these strains, which themselves had no E molecule and therefore didn't delete, gave rise to a deleting F1, presumably by virtue of a complementation of the non-MHC gene with the E molecule of the C58. Counting the genes that were involved in this deletion was achieved by making back crosses of the F1s of C58, which each of these strains then back-crossed on the C58, and looking by a standard segregation analysis at the percentage of animals that showed the deletion phenotype. And for these strains, it was 50%, indicating a single gene, and for these strains, it was 75%, indicating two genes. So it was at this point that we were involved with work on microsatellite analyses. The polymorphic microsatellites that had been described by John Todd, and in fact Andy Knight from our lab went to John Todd's lab to help develop those microsatellites a couple of years ago, and they were at a stage of development at that point that we had this data, and we knew we were attempting to track down these ligands, that I decided that it would be a very sensible use of our expertise and resources to look at the co-segregation of these deletion ligands with microsatellites. And that's how we started the mouse mammary tumor virus search. At least, we were not looking for mouse mammary tumor viruses at all. But as soon as we got chromosomal locations using our microsatellite analysis, MTVs were one of the other chromosomal markers that we looked at. And as soon as they were put into the analysis, there were no recombinants between the deletion phenotype and the MTVs. And there's some examples of that in the next few slides. Next slide, please. This is one of the back crosses that I mentioned, BALB with C58, back crossed onto the non-deleting C58. A quarter of the animals not deleting at all. 75% of the animals deleting, although very interestingly, you'll see that these are subdivided into a group of about 25% that have this partial deletion phenotype and the other half that have the total deletion phenotype. And the MTV analysis showed that the partial deletion phenotype always was associated with inheritance of MTV8 from the BALB-C, whereas the total deletion phenotype was associated with MTV9, which is on chromosome 12 and came from the BALB. And just by chance, you would, of course, expect to have half of the animals that had inherited MTV9 inheriting MTV8, but there was no further change in phenotype when you have the gene that causes this co-inherited with the gene that causes that, then you can only have a similar sort of phenotype. Next slide, please. This is a similar back cross involving B10BR, in which the results are essentially the same, with the partial deletion phenotype representing a quarter of the animals and associated with MTV8, and MTV9 accounting for the total deletions. So here are two inbred strains, B10BR and BALB, for which the V-beta 11 deletion ligands are identified. The following strain we looked at, next slide please, was different in as much that although the partial deletion phenotype animals had MTV8, these mice did not have MTV9 on chromosome 12, but they did have MTV11 on chromosome 14, and all the animals that had this almost complete deletion phenotype turned out to have inherited MTV11. The next slide, please. And this is just to show the sort of southern blot analysis in which we analyzed animals that, from this last back cross I've just shown you, the non-deleting animals, they've obviously all inherited the MTV genomes of the back cross strain C58 and variable amounts of the other MTVs. But amongst the total deletion phenotype group, you can see all of those that have deleted have inherited this MTV11, which would account for that, their deletion phenotype, and none of those that did not delete have that MTV. Can I have the next slide, please? Now, I'm just going to very quickly show you some V-beta-3 data, which is new. Some of it's been published and some not. The analyses are really essentially the same as the previous ones, except that the V-beta-3, which is associated with the MLSC phenotype, which is also one that stimulates primary proliferative responses in vitro, in contrast to the V-beta-11, where B cells from the periphery, from mice that express the MTV 8, 9, or 11, do not stimulate T cells, V-beta-11 positive cells, from strains that do not have those MTVs. And I don't think there's anything fundamental that distinguishes the MLS type expression from the MLS-like expression. The MLS, like A and C, which have been identified by Festenstein as the primary lymphocyte-stimulating antigens, which are associated with deletion, and it's just that some MTVs are associated with deletions but not stimulations, for reasons we don't altogether understand, but the biology of them otherwise is entirely parallel. And this is one where at least some of the MTVs, particularly MTV6, is strongly stimulatory for the MLSC phenotype. Now, here the back cross has involved. The V-beta-3 is deleted on the A molecule rather than the E, so we don't have to worry about the presence of the E molecule. And the back cross was done to B10, and the genes that the bulb C is the one that deletes V-beta-3, BLAC10 background animals do not. And the back cross shows that half of the animals delete and half don't. It's a single gene, and the MTV involved is MTV6. In another combination that also, in another strain, C58, which also deletes V-beta-3, the MTV is in fact MTV3, and you can see that from this back cross with AKR, where again you've got a 50-50 segregation and complete concordance of the deletion phenotype with the inheritance of MTV3. Now, it's a rather more complex story when you're looking at the V-beta-3 deletion ligands derived from the A strain, because here again you've got 25% roughly of the animals that show this partial deletion phenotype. These are all associated with inheritance of MTV13, and contrast with this complete deletion phenotype of animals that have inherited MTV6 from the A strain, with or without the presence of MTV13, which can't have any additional effect. And we have a similar story here, in as much that MTV1 is responsible for this partial deletion phenotype, whereas MTV6, as here, is responsible for the total deletion phenotype. For the next slide, please. Now, this is a new MTV, which Sue Fairchild discovered, looking at back crosses of CBA with NZWs back crossed onto CBA. So the deletion ligand is coming from the NZW, which deletes V-beta-3, whereas the CBA strain, this is not CBAJ, this is CBACA. In fact, it's the T6 marked CBACA. And there again, we have a proportion of deleters and partial deleters and complete deleters, which suggest that there are two or three genes involved in the deletion phenotype, of which it's fairly easy to identify the complete deletion ligands as being either 3 or 6. But when we did the blots, we found none of the previously described MTVs associated with this partial deletion phenotype. So the next slide shows some of those blots, and it just illustrates four animals from each of the groups, non-deleters, partial deleters, and total deleters. And you can see in the loading well here a band which is showing up with our MTV probe. This is the 5' probe. If the same blot is actually probed with the 3' probe, we also get an internal fragment at 2.5 kilobases, which is derived, we think, from the same MTV. This caused a great deal of trouble at the time. We've cut this with all the enzymes that we currently use in the lab, and we haven't cut that large molecular weight band at all, but there's no doubt about its co-inheritance with partial deletion, and we've named this, in fact, MTV44, and it's currently being sequenced at the lab, and for reasons that I'll explain in just a moment, you would expect that to have sequences at the C-terminal end, which were similar to the other four MTVs I've told you about that delete V-beta-3. It's MTV 3, 1, 6, and 13. Next slide, please. Okay, now, could we focus, please? This is just a summary to show you the current knowledge with respect to a number of inbred strains of which of the MTV genomes they have, which have now been shown by back-cross analysis to have an effect on the T-cell repertoire by causing deletions, and I've underlined all of those that do. There are some innocents here. V-beta 17 crops up all the time, and that's not been shown to be responsible for any V-beta selection. And in this column, I've just indicated the different V-beta families which are partially or completely deleted. Can I have the next slide, which shows that in a slightly more simplified way? I've listed the V-betas that are selected by these different MTVs, and I've listed here which of the H2 molecules they have to be presented with. And you can see there are examples where only the E molecule presents effectively, but more examples where the A can present this superantigen, but the E is better. Now, from this, you will see that there are a number of different MTVs, which affect certain V-betas, and 3 and 11 are good examples of those. But there are also cases, and this is a group that is an obvious one, V-beta 6, 7, 8.1, and 9, which are deleted by one MTV completely, and data that I've not shown you, but also work from our lab, which is in press at the moment, which has shown that this same V-beta, MTV44, which was discovered originally because of its propensity to partially delete V-beta 3 cells, also partially deletes the V-beta 6, 8.1, and 9. So what is the basis of the V-beta specificity? The next slide also points out another problem, if you like, that we really can't account for why some MTVs partially delete and others totally delete. This is the data for V-beta 3, which has the most MTVs that affect its expression, but the same is true also for V-beta 11. Two of them that we've described completely delete, another one is a partial deletion. I'm going to show you the sequence data in a moment, and it doesn't look as if there are sequence differences to account for this. They could be site of integration, which may in turn affect level of expression or time during ontogeny of expression. Next slide, please. Now, this is work that's been published from the Marek Kapler lab, and you can see from this that the sequence of MTV 8, 9, and 11, which those that delete V-beta 11, give rise to amino acids, which are for the last 20 amino acids at the C-terminal end, which are virtually identical, whereas there are odd changes in the preceding extracellular, part of the extracellular domain. So this would be enough to account for the V-beta specificity of these MTVs. And the next slide illustrates the same point with respect to V-beta 3 deletion. And here are the four that have been sequenced by Anne Pullen, and also the sequences have been confirmed by Hanzacher or Bayer. And you can see from these that, again, the last 20 amino acids of this C-terminal end are virtually identical. And they certainly differ from these MTVs, these exogenous MTVs, in fact, which are responsible for V beta 14 deletion. And here's the consensus sequence. This paper has now been published. But there are some awkward corners to this story, and the next slide shows that. For example, V beta 5 is deleted by both MTV 6 and MTV 9. And they've clearly got very different sequences at the C terminal end. So it may be that there are sufficient binding affinity there, regardless of sequence differences, to do it, or there could be other portions of the molecule that are responsible for the binding, and we can't distinguish between that at the moment. The next slide, please. Okay, now, have I got 2 minutes, Mr. Chairman? Minimum. Okay, well, I'll do a Wiseman, but a much quicker Wiseman. I want to show you positive selection because I think that from the point of view of physiological importance, it could be argued that positive selection is maybe even more interesting than negative selection. Of all the strains here analyzed with QHAE's V-beta 10 specific antibody, all of those that have an E molecule, you've got several different backgrounds here, all of these that have an E molecule have got higher levels of V-beta 10 CD4 cells than those without the E molecule, which would be consistent with positive selection by an E molecule. Have the next slide, please. And this, I'm just going to concentrate on this panel, and in fact, these two columns of figures. This back cross analysis was made from an E positive strain, the A strain, and the NOD strain, which does not have an E molecule. Back crossed onto NOD, and then the animals were phenotyped for their expression of V-beta 10 on the CD4 cells and on the CD8s, but on the CD4s, you can see there are two different populations of mice. And it turns out that H2 analysis of those same animals shows that all of those that have got the high levels of V-beta 10 on CD5 have a heterozygous H2 type, so they've inherited the H2 of A as well as that of NOD, whereas the low expressors have got two copies of the NOD chromosome 17. They don't have an E molecule, and they don't select. And this is quite different to the CD8 cells. There's no selection of the CD8, so this would suggest that this is a positive selection that either occurs in the periphery or perhaps in the thymus, but after the cells are committed to being single positive 8s. Now, you could argue that this might be some sort of universal superantigen expressed by both A and NOD to account for this. That, I think, is perhaps made less likely by this back cross, in which it's the CD8 cells that are showing positive selection, and this is mapping. Here's the group of mice that have the higher level of V-beta 10 positive cells in the CD8 population, and here these animals are characterized by having inherited the NZW H2 type. So there's co-segregation with H2, and the ones that don't have the NZB, that have just got the B10BR type, do not show this preponderance, this selection of CD8 cells. Here's another example of another strain combination where it's not so impressive as this one or this one, but it's statistically significant. And data I'm not going to show you, you'll be relieved to know, Takeshi has, Kyuhei Tominari has discovered that there's a V-beta 2 positive selection of T cells in the periphery of mice, which also co-segregates with H2. But as you see from these data, and is true of this V-beta 2 story, there is no suggestion of any biphasic population of mice here. So all of them have inherited. There doesn't seem to be any polymorphism of a molecule that's not the H2 molecule. Next slide, please. Now, I think I'm not going to go into the discussion of the human T-cell receptor expression because it's extremely muddy and I think not informative one way or the other. So I can have that slide off, please. And that, I think, is all that I want to say today. But I perhaps should round this off by saying that I regard these results that I've told you about as indicating general principles of positive and negative selection. And inasmuch that B retroviruses, type B retroviruses, are not present in human beings or even rats, I think it would be unwise to argue for the specifics of this sort of V beta selection as being physiologically important. And I think it would be more reasonable to argue that it's unlikely that V beta selection is going to create important holes in the physiological repertoire, because there are plenty of other sorts of receptors that could take over for peptide-specific recognition. So I merely would say that this is a marvelous way of showing us that positive and negative selection occurs, and that we should be looking for other, perhaps more physiological molecules, but ones which create much more discrete holes or amplifications of the T-cell repertoire, which in fact are going to be very much more difficult to look at. Thank you, Len. Thank you, Lee.
The structure of the retroviral superantigens and the bacterial superantigens, are they similar or different?
Well, there's a lot known about the sequences of them, which are really not homologous at all. So one assumes that at a structural level they have to be similar. But I mean, the sequence is known, but we certainly don't know their, there's no crystal structure on those. It's quite possible that somebody in this audience knows more than I do. What you're asking is whether the transfection experiments don't strictly speaking address that question, because you could argue that in transfecting these constructs into cells, that you're merely turning on a cellular gene. We have actually made now large quantities of open reading frame product and are about to present that to appropriate hybridomas. But the problem is that if those don't work, that's not also going to be informative, because from the information that we already have about them being integral membrane proteins, it would be very difficult to visualize how solubilized products of these are going to be appropriately associated with class II molecules. Although it has to be said that there's a real paradox in the in vitro and in the in vivo results attempting to address the question of whether the stimulating superantigen can be transferred between cells or not. I mean, with the bacterial superantigens, clearly you can sprinkle it onto the antigen-presenting cells. There seems some in vivo evidence that you can transfer superantigen, endogenous superantigen, from cell to cell, but that's never been replicated in vitro. So I have to say that you've asked an extremely sticky and pertinent question that I can't answer.
Liz, you mentioned in passing that in Nod mice, the Y chromosome has an MMTV insert. And my guess by the convention of your cross of Nod by A by Nod, you did female. Is there any evidence that the MMTV on the Y chromosome is a superantigen and deletes, and does that MMTV have a name also?
It's got a name, and it's got a number, in fact. There's no evidence that it deletes, because the T-cell repertoire of male and female Nod mice is similar. So you would expect there to be difference between males and females. Yes, of course, the females have got the high incidence of disease and the males have got the low incidence. But I'm afraid there's no easy way around that. There's also, the Nod mice have only got two MTVs, of which only one looks functional. That's the MTV 11, the MTV 3 on chromosome 11. And very interestingly, I didn't actually show that slide because I thought it would cause enormous consternation. It's one I did show when I came to Stanford last year, and we've done some follow-up on this, that when we were mapping the MTV 3 the V beta 3 deletion ligand from Nod and made back crosses with V10, We found that in those backcross mice that had inherited MTV3, which is on chromosome 11, a proportion of them that had inherited that MTV3, and who all of whom were deleted V-beta-3, had an additional band, which was slightly larger than the MTV3 band, but co-segregated exactly with MTV3. We never saw this additional band in the animals that hadn't done MTV. And then we tracked back the whole colony, and we found that our colony is mixed with respect to this second band. We've got some two-band animals and some one-band animals. And we're in the process of actually deriving two different sublines of our nod colony, one-band and two-band. I bet you your bottom dollar that it'll have no physiological significance whatsoever, although you might argue that it could. But we've also looked because of our microsatellite probes, we've screened through very closely. We've got about 20 microsatellites that pick up polymorphisms between a variety of different strains on chromosome 11. There are no other polymorphisms. There are no other micro-heterogeneities in our nod colony with respect to those other markers on chromosome 11. And we've done a random slew through the rest of the chromosomes. And ours have been brother-sister mated for more than 60 generations. So it's very interesting that we've maintained this heterogeneity and I haven't seen anybody else report this from their nod colonies, but I suspect it's a complete red herring.
Liz, can I ask you a question? Has anybody investigated any possible tissue-specific expression of the open breeding frame?
People who first described the open reading frame were the virologists at ICRF in London in the early 80s when they thought that mouse MTV would be a good paradigm for human breast cancer. And they found the open reading frame and the quantities that were transcribed from anything were so minute that they couldn't actually do any further work on it. And it seems as if T cells, being as sensitive as they are, their ability to pick up tiny quantities of material, I think we all know about, that this at the moment remains the only way of looking for expression. There aren't any bona fide antibodies. There's some anti-peptide antibody, which Peter Robinson in our lab has developed, in which we've done some co-precipitations with our in vitro translated product, but we haven't tied up and done the experiment that you, Don, were asking in using those. We've attempted to use in vitro translated products to stimulate hybridomas, but the quantity is probably insufficient to do that anyway.
Well, the obvious reason for asking the question is does thymic medulla, thymic epithelial cells do express that?
And dendritic cells don't seem to either. And in fact, Charlie Sidman did some work, and I think Ed Palmer, treating mice with anti-mu to suppress their B-cell development, and those that have their B-cell development suppressed don't delete as well as those that do. So it looks as if it's B-cells circulating through the thymus that could be the antigen-presenting cells triggering this.
This may have something to do with the partial deletion phenotype, then. I mean, if you don't have a deletion in the thymus, then in the periphery you may have different things, less stringent.
Well, it's the same. In the mice that show the partial, when you segregate the partial and the total deletion, you're talking about segregation of genes that together exist
in some mice you may have a tissue-specific expression that is different from others.
Yes, I think that integrations may be... B-cells are the only cells... There's a little bit of... There's some evidence that T-cells may express low levels of the open reading frame. B-cells clearly express lots, but there's no other cell type in the body apart from mammary tissues with the exogenous virus for which there's any evidence that there's expression. Well, I think that data will have to be reproduced. Right. I think that there were the problems about the original data was that some of the baselines were such that people found them rather strange. And, of course, it was done not with an antibody, but with a PCR product method. I mean, I think it's not at all impossible that there is. But I think the data is not compelling at the moment. I haven't seen the Fauci data.
Yeah, I have not. I mean, you mentioned there can be peripheral positive.
So peripheral?
Positive selection.
Well, no, I said that the positive selection we saw with V-beta 10, which has also been seen with V-beta 2, which affects just single one of the, either CD4s or CD8s. That would be consistent with peripheral, but that doesn't prove it. I think that it's just as easy to say that it could occur in thymus. So one will have to do, you know, thymectomies to address that question.
Just a quick comment. I was going to ask the same question, but I wanted to just comment. One of the problems with the HIV superantigen is that it doesn't really explain why you get reduction in CD4 number. Right. It'll explain loss maybe of a few V-bearing families. But it really doesn't explain why you get the gradual loss over time, unless you want to argue mutation, which really doesn't make a lot of sense.
I have nothing to add to that. I mean,
does this also happen to other, like CD4 particles?
Well, the only handles we've got at the moment are antibodies to different V-betas, and strain distribution patterns. And nothing's come out of that rather extensive analysis other than things that were listed on that single slide. Is ubiquitous. I mean, it's much more, yes. But doesn't exclude it. But
one more question. As for B cells, and I think it is possible to image the same mechanism, selection mechanism of B cells with specific V region. Do you have any information or data for B cells selection?
For B cells?
Yeah.
No, I'm a T cell person.
But the same mechanism.
I'm very ignorant about B cells, which is one of the reasons I like coming to meetings like this.
Okay, anyhow, thank you so much. We should proceed to the next.